Good morning, Valley Church, and those that are visiting. We're glad that you're joining us here at this 9 a.m. worship service. As I was walking this morning for about an hour, just enjoying the beautiful weather, nice and cool, and praying, do a lot of prayer walks. A lot of times I'll go through a whole prayer list, but this morning I just said, Lord, I'm just going to praise you and thank you and give you the glory that is due your name. Of course, we have eternity that we'll be doing that, but in these spare moments that we have to really draw closer to the Lord, we'll be singing one of those songs at the end of the service, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. And I pray through the worship, through the preaching of the word, through giving and being with family and friends, that you will indeed draw closer to the Lord. Let's have a prayer before we start this service. Father God, thank you for inhabiting our prayers, our praises, our very beings by the power of the Holy Spirit. That you've restored the identity and the image of who we are to be through Christ, your Son, the only begotten, sent here to serve and give his life a ransom for many. We honor you, Jesus. We thank you. And if there's anybody that is hurting and struggling, Lord, that they would reach out. They would get a hold through the website here, a pastor to pray with, a friend to talk to, Lord. Again, that you would be pleased with all that's said, all that's sung today from our lips to your throne, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Page 43 in your hymnals. And one day, again, we will all be included in that great celebration and adoration of our Lord and King.
All hail the power of Jesus.
and we'll join the everlasting song, and we'll crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown. Let's sing together, Blessed Be the Name, on page 52 of your hymnal. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, Blessed be the name of the Lord, the glories of my God and King. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Sing the chorus, singing. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, blessed be the name of the Lord. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. He breaks the power of canceled sin, blessed be the name of the Lord. His blood can make the foulness clean, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, we blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, we bless your holy name, blessed be the name of the Lord. I never shall forget the day, blessed be the name of the Lord, when Jesus washed my sins away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Singing saints, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, we bless your holy name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. As we prepare our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our offerings, we take this time to reflect and say, Lord, how good you've been to us. Yes, we've gone through hard times, maybe in our life recently, maybe in the past. But in all things, the Lord says he is with us. He will never forsake us. We're thinking of many people as we give. We think of missionaries that are around the world that have struggled through this last year and a half. We think of their families and friends, and we say, Lord, bless our gifts for evangelism, for taking care of Valley Church here on Stelling Road. And so as we go into our time of prayer, we remember those things. Father, again, thank you for all the gifts that you have given us through Christ Jesus. Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no shadow or shifting change. Thank you, Lord, and we ask that as we give, Lord, you will indeed turn these gifts into blessings of salvation to others, meeting their needs physically and, of course, spiritually for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. been said, the greatest thought that we can have at any time of during our life or any time during the day are thoughts about the Lord. And that's what this next song is about. Jesus, the very thought of thee. Page 89. Jesus, the very thought of thee, with sweetness fills my breast, but sweeter far thy face to see, and in thy presence rest. Nor voice can sing, no heart can frame, nor can the memory find a sweeter sound than thy blessed name. O Savior of mankind, O hope of every contrite heart, O joy of all the meek, to those who fall, how kind thou art, how good to those who seek. But what to those who find are this? No tongue nor pen can show the love of Jesus, what it is. None but his loved ones know. Jesus, our only joy, be thou, as thou our prize will be. Jesus, be thou our glory now, and through eternity.
Again, it's great to be singing with my brothers and sisters in Christ, even online. We might not be 1,000 tongues, but we are enough to bring glory to God for sure. And that's this song, "Oh for 1,000 Tongues to Sing." It's on page 21 of your hymnal.
That bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears. 'Tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoners free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me. Hear him, ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues and praise. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Let's read the scripture today, 1 Peter 5, verses 12 through 14. By Silvanus, a faithful brother as I regard him, I have written briefly to you, exhorting and declaring that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it. She who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son. Greet one another with the kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ.
Well, good morning to all of you. Welcome to June. It's good to be back with you. I just returned from almost 4 weeks in Zimbabwe. And I'd like you to turn your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 5. We've been going through 1 Peter now since the first week in January. We've entitled this series, Poised Together, A Journey Through 1 Peter. And I hope that 1 Peter has gotten into your head, into your heart, and has worked its way somehow out into your life as well. And so I want you to imagine for a brief moment that you are perched. You can see that little figure up there. What would you be thinking about? I just asked someone, and they said, well, I think I would be thinking about a sense of awe, perhaps a sense of beauty. Certainly, you would not be thinking about how great you were or how much control that you have. During these last many months, things have been out of control. They haven't been in our hands. And so you'd look down, you'd look around. Hopefully, you'd look up to the one who created all of these things. You probably wouldn't get too close to the edge, because if you get too close to the edge, something could happen. It's that sudden stop down there at the bottom that could actually get you. The title of what I want to share with you today, since we're finishing this book and we've called it Poised, A Journey Through 1 Peter, my question for you and for me: are you poised for the rest of your journey? None of us know how many days we have, but we all know that our journey will end. And I know exactly where you and I are going to end up at the end of our journey. And I'm sure you're thinking, well, where is that, Glen? Honestly, it's not just simple, it's profound, and it will be a grand time, hopefully for us, because you are going to end up at the feet of Jesus. And the reason I say this is because the scriptures are absolutely clear. It tells us in the book of Philippians that after Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point death on a cross, God highly bestowed on him the name above every name. And here's the purpose: so that at the name of Jesus, every knee, yours included, will bow of those who are in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And that, note, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Friends, I hope you're prepared for that day. And those of you that are parents and those of you that are grandparents, you need to prepare your children for that day. I was just chatting with Daniel because a couple of good friends of mine are climbing Half Dome this Sunday, actually. And I think it's a 16, 17-mile trek up and back. You have to prepare for something like that. And we should be prepared, our own hearts, but our children, our grandchildren, our friends, for that particular day. Now we come to our end of the series, and I'd like to read the last few verses of 1 Peter chapter 5. Kurt ended last week with these words in verse 11. To him, this really is the God of all grace and the God of all glory, to him be dominion, that is power and rule and authority forever and ever. Amen. And then Peter writes, through Silvanus, or we would know him as Silas, our faithful brother, for so I regard him, I have written to you briefly, five chapters we've gone through, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God. Now note this last exhortation that he gives us. Stand firm in it. That is in the grace of God. She who is in Babylon, I'm not going to get into different thoughts regarding it, but most think it's Rome, chosen together with you, sends you greetings, and so does my son Mark. Apparently, Paul and John Mark had made some peace there. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace be to you all who are in Christ Jesus. And so the book ends really, really with a doxology, so to speak, of worship. It ends that the fact that we are in a partnership with God in building his kingdom, and faithful brothers and sisters, that we should be exhorting and testifying to one another about the amazing, wonderful grace of God. And that we should treat one another with love and respect, as we've learned through the book of 1 Peter. Now, I have a thesis this morning, and my thesis is this: that Peter's first as well as his final exhortation should be our obsession. All of us are obsessed or driven or consumed with something. And Peter's very first exhortation from chapter 1 is prepare your minds for action. Be sober in spirit, which I think is mentioned 3 times in the book. It means take things seriously. And then fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ, or when Christ returns. And return he will for his own. That's how the book began, the very first exhortation. And then we just saw, I'm testifying and exhorting you, the final, stand firm on the grace of God. We got into the kingdom because of God's grace. We live under grace, and we are to stand firm on the grace of God, which has to do also with the revelation of who he is. So true grace is a pardon for all of our sins and transgressions, so that we can thrive, I put / survive. Some of us during COVID maybe just survived. Hopefully we've thrived in terms of trusting him. But it's also a power so that we can stand. As we were reminded last week, we stand firm against all the flaming missiles of the evil one. We stand firm against the enemy, this roaring lion that seeks to devour. And so we really stand firm in the person of Christ, because Titus 2:11 says, the grace of God has appeared. And that's the coming, the incarnation of our Lord Jesus. Are you standing firm on the grace of God? Are you fixing your hope on him? This morning when I got up, I just Googled and I said, how long does the average teenager spend on his cell phone? Here's the answer, according to the website I hit: 7 hours and 22 minutes a day. The tweens, those are, youngsters, that's 4 hours and 44 minutes. So who is indoctrinating who and with what? And I would submit that if we think that a 30-minute message on a Sunday morning like we're going through here now is going to transform our hearts, our minds, our children, our grandchildren, we better think again. All the Facebook, all the TikTok, all the Instagram, the tweets, the texts, all of this right here, we're getting so many messages, and most of it is not true. And we have to prepare our minds for action, and that's what Peter is telling us to do. And so we're to fix our hope on God, on His grace. The word God is mentioned 4,473 times. The word Yahweh that we see in Exodus chapter 3 when God reveals Himself to Moses is mentioned a plethora of times. Sometimes it's translated Yahweh, sometimes Jehovah, depending on the Bible. The word Jehovah has to do with the personal name of God. And Peter wants us to fix our hope on God. He is the one who exists. The word Jehovah literally means He causes to become. And that's why Jesus says, I am. And as we read through John, we see all of these I am statements. And so what I want to share with you are some thoughts regarding God, Jehovah, that the Lord, first of all, is our provider. I want to remind you of this. It's critical for you and me. In the scriptures, it's Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. And it was revealed to Abraham as he was getting ready to sacrifice his son. And God stops him and says, you don't have to slay your son. And he said, the Lord will provide. Isaac actually said that. And so He has provided for you and me. That's what God does for us. And as we looked at in the first chapter, it all comes through Christ. He's at the center. And so we have a cleansed conscience. We've been sprinkled clean with His blood. He tells us that we've been caused to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. New life He's given us, a new relationship that we never had before, that He is now our Father, that He cares for us. We have an eternal inheritance to obtain something imperishable, undefiled, never fade away, reserved in heaven for us. God has provided something way in the future for you, for me, by His grace and His grace alone. Presently, we have supernatural protection. Peter says we're protected by the power of God for salvation, ready to be revealed when Christ returns. So God is going to protect us until Jesus comes back or we go to be with Him. And then the trials that we go through, they're working for us. They're developing our character. They're developing our faith. As He says here, even though for a little while now you've been distressed by various trials. They come in all shapes and sizes. It's not just COVID, but God is developing our faith. And then He says, even though you have not seen Christ, you love Him. And we do because of all He's done, or at least we should, all He's provided. Because He's poured out His Holy Spirit within our hearts, the love of Christ. And so He says, you rejoice with joy inexpressible. The joy that He has, I hope your heart is filled with joy because of all He's provided for you. And then He ends with this, obtaining as the outcome of your faith. Faith is critical in our journey. The very salvation of your soul. And so all of this is because God has chosen us. He's writing to aliens and strangers and foreigners and those who are being persecuted and who will undergo much more persecution. You and I do not know what the next car coming when we drive at night with its headlights. We don't know anything about that. Nor do we know exactly what's coming toward us as we continue journeying here in the 21st century. But we can worship. Blessed be the God and Father. That's literally what Peter is saying. Bless him for all he's done and what he's provided for you. When we come to the second chapter, especially in 1 Peter chapter 2, if you will recall, this is what it says at the end of chapter 2. He says, you are continually straying like sheep. Maybe you've strayed. But friends, you can return. You can repent. You can come back. He says, you are straying like sheep. But now you have returned, note, to the shepherd and the guardian of your soul. And that's the most precious thing that you possess is your soul and what you have control over. The Lord is our shepherd. And especially in the second chapter, I'd just like to remind you of what Peter reminded us on, of what God has done for us. You know what a shepherd does. One of the things that he does is he leads his sheep. As we know from Psalm 23, the Lord is, not will be, not maybe, is, present tense. David said, my personal shepherd. He makes me lie down in green pastures. That's feeding. He leads me beside quiet waters. He goes and tells us in this second chapter that whoever believes in the Lord Jesus will never be disappointed. When we get disappointed with things, normally it's because we've got the wrong focus and we think that God should do this or that, or perhaps that he owes us. Friends, he owes us nothing. It's all the grace of God. The Lord is my shepherd, David says. And what do shepherds do? Shepherds communicate with their sheep. They know them by name, actually. And in the second chapter, Paul reminds us of who we are, our identity. You're a chosen race. You're not just anybody. You're a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation. And look, you are a people for God's own possession. He purchased us at Calvary with his blood. He possesses us in the fact that he lives in your heart and my heart. He longs to communicate with you. 2 Peter 2:2, as newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the word that you may grow. Grow in what? Grow in your concept of God, that he is your shepherd. He's not going to leave you. He's not going to forsake you. And he leads us in chapter 2, verse 21, by his example. He's left us an example, how we should live. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he did not utter any threats, unlike what we do sometimes. No, he kept entrusting himself to the one who judges righteously. That was his Father. Are you trusting the Father through all your circumstances, even though you may not understand them? That he's leading you? That he's guiding you? Is he your personal shepherd? Are you listening, my friends, please, to his voice daily instead of the rubbish and the foolishness and the lies that we're getting, especially in our IT world? So it tells us here, by his wounds, in verse 24, you were healed. Past tense. God is our healer. And we were straying, and now we come back to him. Whatever it is that you're distraught with, whatever kind of sickness that you feel you might have, go to him. He can heal our broken hearts, restore to you and me. And then he forgives. You were straying, but now you've returned to the shepherd and guardian of your soul. So we see the Jehovah Ra. That was uttered by Jacob, the one who was a deceiver, the one who strayed and wandered and lied and took advantage of his brother. But he says in Genesis 48, you have been my shepherd, Yahweh, from my youth. So he could look back in his life, his journey, and see the hand of God. Have you seen the hand of God in your life? Helping you, trusting you? And then the Lord is, friends, our righteousness. Listen to these words from the book of Jeremiah. This is what it says. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, Yahweh, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he will reign as king and act wisely and do justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, Israel will dwell securely, and this is his name by which he will be called. Now note, the Lord our righteousness. In the third chapter, Peter reminds us that we are to set this righteous one and give him first place in our heart. This is what the scriptures tell us. But in your hearts, yours, mine, set apart, or Christ apart as holy, acknowledging him, giving him first place in your lives as Lord. The word is kurios. For indeed, it goes on in verse 18, Christ died for sins once for all, the just and righteous for the unjust. That's you, that's me, so that he might bring us to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but he was made alive in the spirit. And so Romans chapter 5 is a beautiful chapter that by the death of the one, the Lord Jesus, the many have been made righteous. And so we stand, my friends, in the righteousness of Christ, not in your own righteousness, not for sure in Glenn's righteousness. I'm so thankful for the grace of God, not only initially in my life, but progressively. And it's the grace of God that will bring us home safely. And so we are to live out this righteousness. And so that's why in the third chapter, he talks about wives, be submissive to your husbands. Husbands, live with your wife in an understanding way. We're to submit one to another. And then it talks about the family relationships, brotherly love and kindness, how we treat each other. We're to love one another from the heart. And you can do that because the righteous one lives in us. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. And so let's let him live his life through us. When you come to chapter 4, one of the words that we find here is from Exodus chapter 31, is the Lord is the one who sanctifies us. In fact, in Exodus chapter 31 that I have here, well, these are the verses that we find in the book of 1 Peter. Chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. It says, therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose. Because the one who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live the rest of his time in the flesh, no longer for human lust, but for the will of God. And in Exodus chapter 31, we have this incident that took place. Let me see if I can just turn there real quickly. Chapter 31, verse 13. And it's a sign of the Sabbath. And it says, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, as for you, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, you shall thoroughly observe my Sabbath. This is a sign between you and me throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you, who sets you apart, who changes you literally from the inside out. And so, you see, we've been called, according to chapter 2, for the purpose of suffering. Suffering gets our mind onto God. Hopefully it would do it. Jesus did when he was on the cross. He entrusted himself to the Father. And so God uses trials in our life to inspect us, to cause us to cry out, that we should not be, as chapter 4 said, surprised at the fire ordeals that come upon us for our testing as though something strange is happening to us. No, this is normal. Suffering is mentioned in every single chapter in 1 Peter. And so it's what we can expect. God has told us ahead of time. He said, in this world, Jesus said to disciples, you will have tribulation. So what is God doing? He's fulfilling his promise. We have tribulation in this world in which we live. It's light and dark. And as we journey through, we encounter the enemy. We encounter the world. We encounter our own weakness of the flesh. Job says, after he has tested me. It's the idea of one who purifies gold, the smelter. I shall come forth as gold. After he has tried me. After he has tested me. So God has a purpose in all of it. And you know what it is? It's to make you like Christ. It's Romans 8:29. That we would be conformed into the image of Christ. That he has given us an example. He didn't revile in return. He uttered no threats. He kept trusting his Father. Everything was in control. He was trusting a sovereign, providential Father. I hope you're trusting him. And what you're going through is to cause you to look to him as your sanctifier. He sanctified us by his Holy Spirit. First chapter of 1 Peter tells us. And then the Lord, friends, is our banner. In Exodus chapter 18, verses 8 to 15, there's a story, if you remember, of Moses against his enemies. And he held up his hands, and when his hands were held up, Israel prevailed. And then his hands got weary, and so he had to have some help to prop them up. And so as long as he had his hands up, as long as it was extended, in a sense for us, a kind of a picture, Israel was victorious. And so it is with us as well. Last week, Kurt, in chapter 5 of 1 Peter, reminded us that we have an enemy. We have the world, we have our own flesh, but we also have an enemy who prowls about, notice, like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. I first on a basketball team for 7 weeks in Kenya, Ethiopia, and Egypt in 1975, I saw my first lion. They devour, okay? They roar basically after they have a kill, after they have eaten. Prior to that, they don't. No, they crouch down in the long grass and they look for their prey. But it says here, prowls about like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And so what does Peter remind us of? Resist him. You don't ever run from a lion if you're in Africa. That's an exercise in futility. They can run a little bit faster. No, you make yourself as as big as you can, I guess, is what they tell us. Resist him, the enemy, firm in your faith. And that's Ephesians chapter 6. Be strong in the Lord. He's our banner. He's our victor. He's our conqueror. Knowing that the same experiences and sufferings are being accomplished by your brothers and sisters who are in the world. And so we stand firm in Christ. And then as Peter ends his book, as I shared these verses at the beginning, he says, peace be to all who are in Christ. That's shalom. It's the peace of God. It's what God told to Gideon when Gideon was so fearful and when he told him to go up against the Midianites. He was a judge, if you remember, Gideon, and he was so fearful. He had to throw out a few fleeces here and there. And God says to him, hey, listen, I'm your peace. I'm the one who's going to conquer. I'm going to go before you. And so Gideon delivered God's people from the Midianites. And Christ is our peace. He himself, according to Ephesians 2, is our peace, who made both groups into one, broke down the barrier of the dividing wall. No matter what the color of our skin, our educational background, or tribe, or tongue, or people, or nation, it does not matter. He is our peace. And Jesus came and he preached peace. He preached peace to his disciples. Peace be to you. And so the Lord Jesus is in fact our peace. Are you at peace? Remember we started at the beginning of our time today? You are going to end up at the feet of Jesus. Are you prepared for the rest of your journey? Prepare for that day. And in between, worship. Worship at the feet of Jehovah Rapha, who heals all your diseases. Do you remember when God's people came to the waters and they were bitter? And Yahweh, Moses, through Yahweh, made the waters sweet so he could quench the thirst of his people. And at the feet of Jehovah Shema, who is always present, it's the name of God for that, and whose dominion, Katros, rules for time and eternity. And that word Katros there has to do with power and rule and authority. Same word in Ephesians chapter 1. The same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, Paul says, lives in you. And we are to live that kind of a life in the midst of an alien, foreign, dark world for Jesus' sake. I want to close with a true story. Several years ago, there was a young boy by the name of Howard Kelly. He was about 10 years of age, and he came from the inner city. He was poor, and he was trying to raise some funds for a school. And he would go door to door and knock on doors and try to sell a few things to earn some money. And he was having a bad day, wasn't having any luck whatsoever. And now it was later on, it was after lunch, and he was hungry. And he says, the next door that I knock on, I'm just going to ask if I could have something to eat because I'm starving. So he knocks on this door, and this young woman opens the door, and she says, can I help you? And he froze. And he didn't ask for a meal, and was kind of panicking, didn't know what to do. He says, could I just please have a glass of water? I'm thirsty. And she looked at him. She could tell that he was maybe even a little bit more than thirsty. And she brought out a huge glass of milk, and he drank it down. And he looked at her and says, thank you so much, ma'am. What do I owe you for this? And she says, no, there's no way. My mom told me that we should never ask for anything for kindness. And so he went and he earned a little bit of money here and there. He went through school. He went through the university. He went through medical school. And he was an expert in the rare kinds of diseases. And so he was called in a particular hospital for a rare case that no one could figure out or diagnose. And so he began to ask some questions about the case and who the person was and so forth and where the person was from. And he found out that this person was from the same hometown that he grew up in. And so he just began to wonder a little bit. And he says, well, could I go see her? It was a woman. And so he went into her room, and she had been hospitalized for a long, long time. And as soon as he saw her, he recognized her. But she, him in his white robe and obviously much older, didn't recognize him. And he took a very, very special interest in this case. And over a period of time, was able to come up not only with a diagnosis, but with a cure. And when she was getting ready to be released, he went into the finance office. He says, could I see the bill? The bill was thousands of dollars. And he signs his name on it, and then he signs something else. And when the woman went, she was so nervous. She had spent all of her money. Her insurance money was all gone. And she was just going to be shocked at the size of this bill. So when she gets the bill, it's signed Dr. Howard Kelly, paid in full with a glass of milk. Friends, Jesus paid it all, paid in full with his own blood, as we're reminded in 1 Peter chapter 1. You are not redeemed, friends, with silver or gold, but with precious blood as of a lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. And friends, that is called the grace of God. If you haven't experienced it, you need him, because you are going to end up at his feet. And hopefully that will be a glorious day when you look into his marvelous face, the God of all grace, the God of all comfort. Father, thank you so much for our journey through 1 Peter. I feel like we've kind of just scratched the surface of what Peter has been writing. Certainly it's pertinent for us living in the 21st century and what we've been going through, and we don't even know what the future holds, but we know you hold the future, that you are a sovereign, providential God who sees to things ahead of time, and that you are our provider, and that you are our shepherd, and that you alone are our righteousness and our sanctifier, and that we can come under your banner, under your authority, because you are the one who fights for us, and you have won the victory, and you are our peace, our shalom. And if anyone has never come to you, today could be the day when they pour out their hearts and realize that they could never pay for their sins or transgressions or iniquities, but that they would trust in Christ and his shed blood for forgiveness of sins and life eternal. Yeah, we bless you today, Lord, even as we started this book. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus. Thank you. In your name, amen.
I believe this is every one of our prayers, not only today, but through that journey with Christ as we walk with him, just a closer walk with thee, Lord. That's our plea. That's our prayer. That's our desire. Page 564 in your hymnals. Let's sing together.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee, just a closer walk with thee, Jesus. Granted, Jesus is my plea. World.
none but thee. Thank you, Jesus. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is over, sing it, saints, just a closer walk with thee. It's the greatest thing in life. Granted, Jesus, it's our plea. As we daily are walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it.
We're so happy to have Patrick and Sonja Jensen with us here today. We've had a long, great relationship with the Jensens over the many years. Patrick was an engineer here in the Silicon Valley, and maybe he'll tell you a little bit about that. But welcome. We're so happy you guys are here. Tell us about what's been going on and what you've got coming up.
Well, just to go back a little ways, I actually was saved here in Valley Church. And God called me to go out to serve him on the mission field from Valley Church. And we spent many years, we were in London, that's where I met Sonja. And also we had many years in serving the Lord in Turkey. And following that time, we've been in Jordan, in Amman, for the last 4.5 years, learning Arabic. That's a new language for us. And preparing, really, learning the culture, the Middle East culture, to go to Iraq. And we believe God is calling us to go to northern Iraq, and we will be going there in August.
That's great, Patrick. And I know there are some challenges there that you're headed to. We read the news. We understand that area of the world has got a lot of challenges, and you've been right in the thick of it, working with refugees and people in great need, displaced persons. Tell us a little bit about what is ahead of you there.
Please pray with us that we are going to go to northern Iraq. It's called Dohuk. In Dohuk, they have 27 ethnic groups camps, refugee camps from northern Syria and Sinjar, Yazidis, and also from Mosul. The people who fled from ISIS, they all came to northern Iraq, Dohuk. That with that place, we like to share the gospel and pray with us that we can really share and they can be saved and can be discipled. And we like to have many multiple house churches that we can send them back to their own country. So pray with us, we can share the gospel, and also pray that we can find the ministry center that we can share the gospel and disciple them, and also job training. You know, the Syrian refugees and Iraqi refugees, they need a job training so that they can really go on with their life. So pray with us and pray for our safety. And
yeah, also for our kids, we've got our son Joseph, he's 21, and our daughter Kyra, she's 17, and our son Elas, who's 15. The two younger ones will be in boarding school, but pray for them as well, because they're very much a part of the ministry, just the way all of you are a part of the ministry, because we really are all together in this ministry to the Lord.
Amen. Well, Patrick and Sunja and the family will be here at Valley Church this weekend. And if you come to church on the grass, you get a chance to see them and reconnect or maybe meet them for the first time. And we'd love to have that happen. How long are you guys in the Bay Area for?
Until the 15th of June.
Okay, so not very much time, but anyway, they're around, and I'm sure we'd love to reconnect with those of you who love them and supported them and pray for them. Thank you so much.
Thanks again for joining with us, and I don't want you to leave 1 Peter. Let it continue to take root in your heart, and especially on the nature and character of God. Look, we start a new series coming up next week, Church on the Grass. You can sign up before, and we've been sharing with you about some things that are happening in the future, especially on the 20th. We'll give you some more information on that, but that's where you can check our website. Just a few brief announcements. Starting June the 9th on a Zoom meeting, there's going to be a women's study in the book of Psalms. So please take advantage of these opportunities that we have. Men's breakfast coming up. We've got quite a number of men that have signed up for it. June the 12th from 8 to 10. And we'll have a great time together. And men's bowling as well on June the 19th. And VBS, July 12th to the 16th. You can sign up online now as well for that. Just register on our website. And all church huddle. We want to just communicate to you as we begin, hopefully, to open up indoors as well, what's coming up for us. So we're going to have an all-church huddle after the service on the 27th. And for the rest of our ministries that we have in our community groups, opportunities to connect, please visit our website. God bless you. Have a great week.